Beam. I am known on this level of the tower, as Jaime in Fuego, and if it please ya, join me here for a bit of palaver on Hail to Stephen King. That's right, you can just call me Fuego for short, and I am here to cordially welcome you to the horror show and my twice weekly program, every Terrifying Tuesday, aka Tower Tuesday, and every Scarific Spooktacular Saturday. I've been doing this for nearly 160 episodes now, nearly 3 years, and it is always such an awesome honor to be here with all of you. So, there's another episode that was already in place for today, and this seems to have been happening a lot lately, and I've even seen it joked about by some of the members of the Hail to Stephen King Ka-Tet, which is the Facebook group that I run. And they're like, man, with all these announcements, like, Fuego doesn't even need to, you know, play in two episodes a week. He can just wait for the next announcement of whatever new property is being adapted and then just have one episode in the can every week. And then you can just push those ahead and whatnot. And I can have, you know, more of a time-sensitive episode that's about the news, and then I can have more of an evergreen episode. Well, I had an evergreen episode, and then news dropped today that my favorite Richard Bachman book. Now, it's not by a large margin, though, because seriously, Roadwork, and also, I mean, I really like The Regulators, I really like Thinner, I also really like The Running Man, but at the end of the day, I probably enjoy the most when King went dystopian with Bachman, so that, yeah, probably The Running Man and The Long Walk. I contend The Long Walk is the best thing that King wrote under the pseudonym of Richard Bachman, and I think it really has a lot to do with, like, where he was when he wrote this book, because it was July of 1979, and I guess, spoilers, the book of the month for Hail to Stephen King in July. I haven't even announced what the June book is yet, but I bet you can assume what the book of the month in July is going to be. Whatever could it be? Anyway, so The Long Walk comes out in 1979, and I mean, we were just finishing up a terrific resurgence in horror. Lots of smart science fiction was written in the 70s, and plus King had just got done doing The Stand, and so, I mean, this book was written about the same time. I'm trying to recall the specifics as to if it was already in the can before The Stand, and then, you know, he just decided to throw it out. It is almost 400 pages, so it is like one of the longer Bachman books. It's like three, it's closer to four. I know it's three and some change, like 360, 380, something like that. But it was released as a paperback, though, so that is one thing to keep in mind. If it was a full-on hardcover, we didn't even get a hardcover release of it until it was collected there in the Bachman books, along with Rage and Roadwork and The Running Man. So, anyway, The Long Walk is basically King and his dystopian awesomeness because of the fact that in the not-too-distant future, there's essentially something called The Long Walk, or shortened to The Walk, and it's essentially where you have a bunch of teenage boys, and they set out on this course starting, I believe it's like the Canada, like Maine border of sorts, and then they just basically start marching down the eastern coast, and, you know, they have to keep a pace of, if I remember correctly, 4 miles an hour. It's been a little while since I've read The Long Walk, but I'm very excited for a reread in July. So yeah, they have to maintain the speed of at least 4 miles an hour, if not more, and there is this strange kid. I'm trying to remember his name. I want to say he was like the illegitimate son of the major in it, and the major is like the military, you know, government, whatever person who just, you know, sends the boys off at the very beginning of this journey, and everybody kind of reveres him at first, and then at the end they're thinking, yeah, this guy's like a manipulative asshole. And so there's this one kid who is, he's leading the charge almost, and he's kind of like a favorite. I want to say Stebbins, maybe. Anyway, and then Garrity is our main character. He's the kid from Maine. He's like the all-American kid or whatever. McVries, whatever. He was the kid that I always liked the most because he definitely, to me, had kind of a Cuthbert Eddie Dean kind of vibe to him, or Larry Underwood type vibe. You know, he was like the sarcastic one with kind of like a dark sense of humor, little bit of a mean streak to a degree, but not as bad as like some of the other characters, because there's one that tries to, I cannot remember the antagonist's name, because, you know, the Stebbins kid, if that, Son of the Major, if I remember correctly, he's like the dark horse that nobody, like people, they see how good he is and his potential to win, but he's not, like, he's more of like a mysterious Joker card in comparison with the main antagonist kid, who is like super asshole, and he gets it, like, he's antagonizing our musketeers, which is what McFreeze and Garrity and like a few of the other kids, they form this little pact, and they're like, okay, even if, you know, even though we all have to eventually screw each other over, because the idea of this walk, this contest, is to be the last kid walking. So, can't stop for more than 30 seconds, and it's just walk, 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 and you're not supposed to go and, you know, get, you know, things from pedestrians. You can, like, get your supplies at the beginning of the day, you know, some water and whatnot, and you get NASA space food at the beginning and stuff, but yeah, really, it just boils down to, you can't stop for more than 30 seconds, keep at least a 4-mile-an-hour pace going, and you cannot stop. Yeah, crazy, right? And I know a lot of stuff was influenced by this as the years went on. I mean, look at something like Battle Royale, look at a more recent, you know, subject like, I don't know, The Hunger Games, and I've even had some people tell me that Maze Runner has kind of, like, taken some inspiration from this. I haven't seen any of The Hunger Games or Maze Runner stuff, but I know that those are about youth in, like, these kind of life or death competition type situations and stuff in a dystopian future. And so, yeah, it's just interesting because the boys form bonds, you know, our musketeer troop especially, but then, obviously, like I said, you have the antagonist, and then you have the mysterious character who, Garrity, there is one point in this book that I just loved where they have the Alice in Wonderland references and Alice's Adventures in Wonderland, and then even more so its sequel, Alice Through the Looking Glass, are two of my favorite books of all time. Absolutely adore them. And he's the one kid, the mysterious kid, who is like the illegitimate kid of the majors. Like, he's like, yeah, I'm kind of like the white rabbit in this race, you know? And then you even make the connotation, you're like, okay, yeah, you know, rabbits are like running around and people chase, like animals chase rabbits and certain hunting situations and stuff like that. If I remember correctly, that is definitely a big connotation and kind of the vibe I want to say his name is Stebbins, that he gives up. But so yeah, it's really, at the end of the day, this is the book that in 79, in my estimation, sowed the seeds for these great stories of just young boyhood camaraderie that we get in The Body, aka Stand By Me, as adapted by Rob Reiner, that we get in Stephen King's It, which everybody knows in September, you know, we have that new entry coming. But also, I'm sure we're going to see some influence in The Institute, also coming out in September, which is King's newest book, which a lot of people are speculating, because they're saying, okay, it's It meets Firestarter. They're like, are these kids being groomed to be breakers? Is there going to be some sort of tower connection in this? Nobody really knows, and we won't until September, but this, in my estimation, was the story that laid the roadwork, the groundwork, if you will, for those stories coming on later on, you know, in King's, you know, bibliography and amazing, you know, 4-decade-plus writing career now. And so, yeah, really interesting that we have had two different failed attempts at adapting this property previously. So in 88, we had George Romero, who was trying to get it off the ground, and, you know, he was a longtime protege of King's, you know, between Creepshow, between trying to adapt a few other properties, unsuccessfully, unfortunately, but he also did The Dark Half, and, you know, just maintained a friendship with King for decades, and with good reason. You know, George Romero was, and King still is, just that you could see why they would bond with their love of old school horror, you know, from the 50s and 60s when they were growing up, and just the fact that they were such sharp, groundbreaking minds, you know, in their own accord, in their own fields of just horror expression and creation and stuff like that. So that didn't end up happening in the 80s, regrettably. But then, like, the dream come true transpires around the time that The Mist was happening, that Frank Darabont secures the rights. Yeah, that Frank Darabont, the same one who did The Shawshank Redemption and did, you know, The Green Mile and my personal favorite, The Mist. Yeah, he secures the rights and he just kept renewing them for over a decade until 2018. the rights eventually lapsed. He just couldn't, I don't know if he just couldn't find the time, couldn't get the right collaborators, couldn't, I mean, whatever it was, it just didn't end up transpiring. And so one of the most heralded and celebrated Stephen King adapters in Frank Darabont was not able to get this project going, which is a real bummer, you know. You know, he was busy creating The Walking Dead initially, at least shortly after The Mist, and you know, he even used a bunch of people from The Mist in The Walking Dead, you know, between Dale and Carol and whatnot, and so, and Andrea. But yeah, so that was a bummer that that never transpired, but got some renewed interest in this when last year in 2018, it was revealed that James Vanderbilt and New Line Cinema had acquired the rights. And yeah, that was after Darabont let them lapse, and so they were immediately trying to get something in production, into production, but they just didn't know exactly what it was going to entail. And so, big thing that was just announced today is that the project is finally getting off the ground, we have a director, and we officially have something in motion. Now, just to give a little background on the producer, James Vanderbilt, he's shifted more so into a producing role after earlier in his career. He was more so a writer, and sometimes he would produce, like, he did Darkness Falls, you know, yeah, pretty good. He also did The Amazing Spider-Man, the first one, and, regrettably, the second one, you know, I believe writer and producer on both of those. But really, his crown jewel for me is his collaboration with David Fincher when he did Zodiac. I think Zodiac is a tremendous movie. I mean, between Gyllenhaal and Downey Jr. sharing the screen together, I mean, terrific. His more recent output, not so much, but that's the thing. I mean, the fact that he's not writing this, to the best of my knowledge, he's just at least on board to produce, and then he has personally picked an up-and-coming name in horror that I'm very excited to mention. The director's name is André Overdahl, and he's a European dude, and he did an amazing film, in my estimation, that he's only got two under his belt now, and one we still haven't even seen yet, but Overdahl did a little film called The Autopsy of Jane Doe that had just a terrific performance from Emile Hirsch, and the name of the other actor is eluding me, and y'all are gonna give me tons of shit in the comments for not knowing that off the top of my head, but so many names, so many moving pieces here. Sometimes, you know, I've just loved Emile Hirsch ever since, you know, The Girl Next Door, and I think the kid has lots and lots of acting chops and talent and stuff. And so The Autopsy of Jane Doe was this creepy, moody, slow burn about, well, basically this corpse that is taken in by this father and son to their mortuary, their morgue that they run and stuff like that. And, you know, they're supposed to be getting her dressed up, you know, cadaver status and whatever, but her name is Jane Doe because I have no idea who the hell she is. She was unearthed in, like, the basement of this house, if I remember correctly. And just weird stuff starts going down with this corpse right away. And besides the corpse, just a storm rolls in, and there's power fluctuations, and, you know, they wonder if this corpse is still alive, and if so, like, if she is still alive and she's not a corpse and she's not really dead, what is she? Is she a demon? Is she a witch? Is she something completely different? Is she like a creature in some sort of like disguised, you know, wolf in sheep's clothing scenario? And I'm not here to spoil anything, but I am here to say that that film was legit masterfully directed by Overdahl, and I have been super stoked about what his next move would be. And his next move is none other than the produced slash written Guillermo del Toro that he is directing Scary Stories to Tell in the Dark, which is a property that literally gave me nightmares and didn't allow me to sleep in the dark. I had to have a nightlight until I was like 10 because of stuff like Scary Stories to Tell in the Dark and all of those disgusting illustrations. And you know, that's an anthology, and they're adapting a few different stories from the spider bite to the big toe to, I mean, ones where I still think of that, just that slimy, gross artwork that we had, and I'm just like, oh god. And it has a similar dark vibe and just very slickly but almost borderline gothically produced approach. And the fact that they are giving the reins to this dude, to Overdahl, is just fantastic. I'm equally excited at the fact that the house that Freddy built, New Line Cinema, are the ones actually producing this. You know, they are behind It Chapter 1 and 2, which, you know, Chapter 2 coming later this September, as I mentioned, and then also the upcoming reimagining in partnership with James Wan of Salem's Lot. So, I mean, between It, Salem's Lot, and then The Long Walk, those are three of the best King properties in my estimation, and I just cannot wait to see this put to screen. And I mean, I don't know. The one thing that I'm hesitant and really curious about is this is a story that could be done PG-13 because it's not necessarily like overly violent, although if I remember, some kid commits suicide and it's like something, does he rip his throat out? I'm trying to remember. It's something nasty, but they could obviously tone that down. And I mean, if the Hunger Games and these things, you know, these YAs, but I don't know. God, I would love for this property to get an R rating and to just be able to go for it. But if it's dealing with kids and if it's dealing with kids like in a death competition of this sort with one another, I mean, it's not The Running Man, you know, it's not that sort of like, you know, kill or be killed. It's more so just, I mean, hey, it's a race and, you know, but there's people who die from like pneumonia, and that's the thing about this joke, since you can't stop and it doesn't matter hell or high water, whatever the weather is, you know, even if you're getting dehydrated, if your legs cramp up, like, you know, if you sprain your ankle, whatever the hell happens, there's no excuse. It's like the Alice in Chains song. I find me sitting by myself, no excuses that I know. Yeah, you'll find me walking by myself, or in this case, stumbling by myself. You have no excuses, you know, because if you win this, if you are the last boy walking, you know, you essentially get the prize, as they call it, and they describe it as anything you want for the rest of your life. So if you have, like, an impoverished family, if you have insane amounts of debt, if you, I mean, just whatever it may be, in this crazy dystopian totalitarian governmental state where, you know, the walk is broadcast for the amusement and enjoyment of all the sick Romans across the country, it's really just, I don't know, this and, I mean, a great reading double feature that you get in the Bachman books, and I love road work. I love, 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 love road work. But really, if you're going to have a double header, there's no better double header in this because they almost feel like they could exist in the exact same level of the tower. Seriously. Like, you've got the long walk, and then, you know, that's for boys. And then for adults, you've got, you know, the actual craziness of the Running Man and where they are actually trying to kill each other. And, you know, people can say what they will about it, but I love that Arnold movie. I think it's great, even if it is a little on the cheesier, campier side, and it's got a much happier ending, obviously, than the plane crash craziness we get in the actual book. But, yeah, nonetheless, if you want a Bachman double feature of just awesome dystopian radness that is King flirting with science fiction in a fascinating fashion, I mean, The Running Man, as I mentioned, but also The Long Walk, tremendous, tremendous. And, you know, you will definitely get that vibe of the young camaraderie that we saw and that endeared itself to general audiences. This is the kind of story that I think will be PG-13. You heard it here first from me. The Long Walk is definitely going to be a PG-13 film. But I imagine it'll be a hard PG-13 if there is such a thing. I've heard that description thrown around by different Hollywood insiders and journalists and fellow creatives, and it just makes me kind of scoff and roll my eyes in a lot of ways. It's just totally, totally silly. But yeah, this is gonna dance on the lines of, you know, an R rating, but it's not gonna go for it. It's not gonna have graphic violence. It'll have more implied violence and like thrilling, you know, terror, and probably just like the feels, man. It's gonna be sad. It's gonna be a really sad movie is what I'm predicting. And I actually think that it could be a sleeper hit and just take a lot of King fans off guard. And yeah, so that excites the hell out of me. And obviously, you know, just the team behind this, the studio behind this, I'm just happy it's finally getting into motion and going to be a reality. That is extremely exciting for, in my estimation, and I know there's a lot of hot debate about this, the absolute best Richard Bachman ever wrote. Well, you know, Bachman was Stephen King until he died of a pseudonym. Anyway, I have been Jaime and Fuego, everyone. Yes, once again, another shorter video because this is something of the utmost pertinence and had to be discussed, especially with as much as I love this property. But yes, just a reminder, I am nearing the finish line on this one. I've been just kind of reading one of the segments and then just jumping back to my Star Wars reading and then doing a little bit of Clive Barker Books of Blood, trying to finish that up so that I can get the first entry of Barker at the Moon up here on the horror show. And then I also have a third segment that I'm going to be announcing very, very soon, which is quite exciting. But yes, Hearts in Atlantis, it celebrates its 20th anniversary this year, you know, whereas the 40th anniversary being 1979 is what The Long Walk will be celebrating in July. But yes, Hearts in Atlantis is the Hail to Stephen King Facebook group book of the month. So if you want to jump on that train with about 10 days left here in the month, yes, if you want to get really ambitious and try to plow through that book, I petition you, I recommend it, I commend you. But yes, on June 1st is when we're going to be having the live Hail to Stephen King Book of the Month discussion all about Hearts in Atlantis. So, you know, get through it, you know, enjoy, and yes, I very much look forward to that palaver. I have been Jaime and Fuego. You can find me on all social media sectors like Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, YouTube, where I have my own personal channel that I have reignited coverage and am ramping up. It is called Infuegotainment, just like you see spelled over there. And yeah, you can basically either search Infuegotainment on YouTube here, or you can just go youtube.com/Jaime and Fuego. Jaime and Fuego spelled just like on all my other social media sectors like the Twits, the Insties, and the Facebeezies. And Facebook, as I mentioned earlier in this video, the Hail to Stephen King Facebook group is where I am the sole admin and moderator. It's where we talk all things Sai King and clan. So we do talk some Joe Hill, who has a big year, you know, coming very soon as well, you know, between Nosferatu, Lock and Key being in development, In the Tall Grass, the adaptation coming to Netflix with his father. So, I mean, yeah, the younger King has a lot of stuff going on as well, but we also talk some Tabby and some Owen from time to time as well. So if you want to be a part of that, all that I ask is that, with the exception of on Friday Freakout and soon to come Manic Monday, yep, I'm gonna add a second day where y'all can just talk different things. I'm thinking, it's not officially a thing yet, but at least for now, Fridays, Friday Freakout, you can talk about stuff amongst the Ka-Tet that is not King related, but just, you know, keep it cool, cordial. But yeah, there's not, with the exception of some of the Pet Cemetery stuff, it's been a pretty copacetic Ka-Tet, which is pretty dope. So you are obviously here on the horror show though, so you like spooktacular content. So if you haven't done the like, share, subscribe thing, hit the bell, which is right over there next to me, so that you get notifications about all the different things we do, from convention coverage. We recently got back from Texas Frightmare. I got to interview some awesome artists there, along with the director of I'll Take Your Dead, Chad Archibald. We have Phoenix Fan Fusion this weekend, this Memorial Day weekend. We are doing a panel on Friday evening, on Saturday evening, and I'm doing a Stephen King panel on Sunday. So very stoked about that. It's all about the year of 19. So if you are in the Phoenix, Arizona area, or have any means to travel there over the course of Memorial Day weekend, from Thursday evening, the 23rd, yes, Thursday the 23rd through Sunday the 27th, I believe it is, yeah, 23rd, the 26th, so the 23rd through the 26th, there it is. That's when there will be over 100,000 people descending upon the Phoenix Convention Center and the surrounding hotels and spots around there, doing all things nerdtastic. It's one of my favorite geek out events of the year. My best geek end of the year. There you go. So I guess that is going to be all of it for today, y'all, until Saturday's pre-taped episode that was originally going to go up today, but you'll see it on Saturday in the midst of the Comic-Con. And also, we will be filming the Year of 19 Stephen King panel, but I don't think we're going to stream it live. Maybe on the Facebook channel. I don't know. Or the Facebook page, I should say. I don't know. Let me know in the comments below. But until then, I guess I shall say hasta luego, sin amigos, and constant readers alike. And yeah, until the Wheel of Ka comes around. What? Huh? But yeah, with that in mind, I guess I shall say until the Wheel of Ka comes around once more. Hasta luego, sin amigos, and constant readers and viewers alike. I am hopeful that we get to share palaver sooner rather than later. Say thank you. And until that instance transpires, remember, stay scared. And read Stephen King, for God's sake. Find The Long Walk. It's in the Bachman books, but it is also available in its own little handy dandy, you know, separate edition as well.